Our next speaker is Svetlana Artemenko, and she's going to talk about photometric and spectroscopic time series of classical T Tauri stars RY Tauri and SU Auriga.
Thank you. Yes, my stars are not EE stars, but T Tauri stars. So, let's start. In classical T Tauri stars, variations of emission line profiles reflect the gas flows, accretion and wind. We carry out long series of simultaneous spectroscopic and photometric observations of two classical T Tauri stars, RY Tau and SU Auriga, with the aim to quantify the accretion and outflow dynamics at timescales from days to years. Numerical simulation shows that the most unstable MHD processes take place at the boundary between the inner disk and stellar magnetosphere. Magnetic field in these stars can be quite complicated. Typically, it is a combination of a dipole and octupole, but the dipole truncates the disk, while the octupole just defines the hotspots on the stellar surface. In solar cycles of activity, dipole component can change drastically. So if in case of classical T Tauri stars undergo solar-like magnetic cycles, we would expect cycles to exist in the position of the inner edge of the accretion disk. Two of the most interesting, most important parameters are co-rotation radius and radius of stellar magnetosphere. The last one depends on magnetic moment and accretion rate. So we pose a problem: whether magnetic cycles affect the accretion and wind processes in the classical T Tauri stars, and can we reveal magnetic cycles by monitoring the dynamics of accretion and wind flows? And so we selected two classical T Tauri stars with an intermediate mass, which sit on radiative tracks. So the stars have radiative core and convective shells. Both stars have similar basic parameters. The mass is about two solar masses. Both stars have fast rotation. Both seen almost the equator on. So we see the stars through the wind disk, in the disk. And the photospheric line depths in the stars remain unchanged at different stellar brightness. So that means that the optical light variability is solely due to the circumstellar dust. Here you can see the examples of light curves. Each panel 1 year, 1 season, and red lines shows the moments of spectral observations. So you can see that variability is not periodic. Here are shown H-alpha line profiles for each season. The data collected mostly in Crimean Observatory, but 1 year we had an international campaign and have more spectral observations. So even here in raw data, one can see that the star was most active in the beginning of our observations and in the end. But in 2016, when we have this campaign, the star was very unvariable. So to estimate how variable a star, we calculated the flux of the line from intensities, and in case the star obscures by the dust, but emitting H alpha emitting line region not obscures by this dust, we will see the linear relationship between the brightness of the star and the equivalent width of H alpha line. So we see this relationship in this plot, and spreading around this line is just because of intrinsic variables of lines, of H alpha line profiles. So here you can see changing variable of flux profiles for each season of our observations. And then we calculated variance profiles for each season to see which part of the line profile is changing mostly, and what is the amount of its variability. And here is the main result of our work so far: variations of the wind activity in Arawai Tau. We see that in 2015, the star was mostly active, followed by minimum in 2016 and 17, and slowly rise to the last season of observations. The similar variability of H alpha line profile shows for second star SU Auriga, and also we see that star was active and non-active again in 2016. This star was also stable, quite stable. H alpha line flux profiles are shown here. We see the alternation of high and low activity in time scale of 2 years. And what is remarkable, that during the quiescent state in 2016, during about 2 months, the wind feature, the central absorption, has almost disappeared, and at the same time, the star was at maximum of its brightness and didn't change much. So what does it mean? No wind, no dust? So my conclusions are that if there is a magnetic cycle in Arawai Tau, it may be around 6 years. In order to confirm this result, we plan to continue a series of observations during at least 2 years more. In SU Auriga, we observe alternations of high and low activity on timescales of 2 years. And during the quiescent state, the outflow became extremely weak for a period of 2 months. In both star, the optical light variability is solely due to the circumstellar dust. So, previous results of our project were published in these two papers. You're welcome to read them. And thank you for your attention.
Questions? Yes, please.
What is the reason you think there should be solar-like cycles? Because magnetic structure is quite different. Yes. In this part, in this star dipole.
Well, in Sun and in Tauri stars, there are dipole component and octopole component, well, multiple component of magnetic field. But cycles are mostly caused by dipole component changing. So if, as we have dipole component, we expect such changes. Such cycles.
Just a comment on that, where there are a few stars where magnetic cycles It seems to me that it is difficult to expect the strong variations of the dipole magnetic field on this time scale. But another source of variability exists, variable accretion rate. But you did not say anything about this.
As a co-author of this project, let me comment this. First of all, in solar case, the dipole component may change drastically very fast, even in 3 years. Also, the solar cycle is 11. So we expect that we can observe something like this here in these stars also. Then about the accretion rate. The accretion rate we control with H-alpha flux. As you know, the flux in emission line is it depends on the accretion rate. So the flux is not that variable in our case. The variable is the variance profile, but the average flux is not much variable. So we control the accretion rate. We know that it is more or less constant. Okay?
So why do you think that it is accretion? Why not outflow? Just a comment. Unusual units, I mean equivalent winds in kilometers per second, but if I correct, it means 300 angstroms equivalent winds, yeah? There is some plot where you have H alpha equivalent winds of versus, equivalent winds in kilometers per second, yeah? In angstroms it will be 300, yeah? Yeah, it means that in H alpha with constant flux, 1% of bolometric luminosity in one line. Just note for this 1% in one line of bolometric luminosity of the star. You don't know that it is accretion. It well can be outflow as well.
But here there is no accretion, there will be no emission line.
Yeah, of course. But.
Interesting.
Variability is due to the wind. Yes, you are right in this sense. The variable profile means variable wind. And and our problem is whether variability in wind reflects the changing magnetosphere configuration.
I see. I agree.
But mass accretion rate in about 10 times larger than mass outflow rate. Therefore, accretion is the main process for formation of emission.
Not yet.
maybe my question is overlapping here. So when the central absorption disappears, but you can still have a wind from emission superimposed, right? Or
well, why not? Why?
Wait a minute, I'm the chair. Any further questions? So before going to coffee, I think to me at least what really was the thing to think about, what bothers me now, no wind, no dust. It bothers me. So let's all go. Thank for the speakers. And we go to coffee and back here in 12:30. 11:30.